My name's Steph, and I'm from the Open Network of Campaign Organizations. We watch what our what my job is to watch what our 19 member organizations are up to all the time. I have the best job in the world. I get to see all the cream on top and none of the bad bits. And I'm going to tell you, I'm going to share with you today a little bit with you what they have been up to in all that crazy time. But before we start, I would really like to know how energized you're feeling on a scale from 1 to 10. Can you please put it in the general chat? Because I want to know how you're up. Whether you're full of beans, whether you feel the blues, whether you're tired, maybe even hungover, long party last night, too much work. How are you feeling? Please share. Right. Did you know that over in Japan, folks use the same symbol or spelling for the word crisis and the word opportunity? It's one and the same for them. It's called kiki. And this, in essence, has been the approach of the open groups when there was the corona crisis, when the corona crisis. Corona, that's serious stuff. And initially when corona came, governments were under shock and had no clue what to do really. And this clueless situation from the part of the government was at the same time a great opportunity for NGOs to come up with bold demands, demands that would never have worked under normal times. Demands for a minimum pay, for eviction moratoriums, for stopping bailouts, or for stopping listed companies to give dividends to shareholders. All these worked at the time of corona. And once they have been adopted as emergency measures, it will be difficult to get them back out again when we are back in normal times. Right now, we are in the next crucial phase. Governments are pretending that they are in control. Ordinary folks know that they are not. They are fed up and they are fearful. And at the same time, the right is rising ever more. And this is because fear. And fear needs to be de-escalated. And I want to share with you today a little bit, a very efficient, we call it a vitamin against fear. It's a medicine against fear. And no, it's not vitamin F. It's a medicine that Eastern European countries master better than anyone else. Can anyone guess what we're going to talk about? Just to give you a hint, it starts with an H, but it's not holy water. What do you think we're going to talk about? Can you put it in the general chat so that I can see it? Come on, guys. What do you think we're going to talk about? It starts with H. It's not holy water. And it's something that is really, really, really efficient against fear. I can't see anyone contributing. Come on, what's going on? Right. Well, then I'm going to share it with you. So we're going to talk about humor. Humor is a really efficient medicine against fear. So humor is irresistible. Humor is great. And when people who are afraid are confronted with humor, usually it makes them laugh, and that makes fear melt away. So with this, ladies and gentlemen, let's raise the virtual red curtain for some COVID-proof tactics that contain a lot of humor to make folks laugh in the face of gray. So if we could go on to the second slide, please. Right. I hope you can all see it clearly because it looks a bit wonky to me from where I'm here now. We call it send items to your target. 1 second. So here, this is a tactic that was trialed by 38 degrees. Oh, 1 second. I think that's Holly. Okay, this is a tactic that was trialed by 38 degrees back in the UK. So there was this crisp company that didn't want to act to basically make their packaging recycle friendly. And so the streets are littered with the crisp packs, because as you know, in British people love their salt and vinegar and all kinds of crisps. And so 38 degrees had a genius idea to encourage their members that each time when they eat a packet of crisps, to mail the empty packet of crisps back to the company who produces them. And 38 degrees has several millions of members, and so the post boxes were full. And this in return brought the companies to their knees, and they had to change their packaging. So it worked. It's a very cheap and effective tactic. Okay, let's go on to the next slide. So at the moment, hopefully lots of people are wearing masks. Masks protect against coronavirus, really important. But masks are also a mini banner. And so campaign organizations have used masks as a mini banner to basically encourage their members to wear them, and like this to add the value of a campaign message to it. If you don't have the funds, I mean, you can see the masks here. They cost quite a bit of money, but what you can also do, you can use mask and you can write in big letters a campaign message, and you can put it on, and that's just as effective. Let's go to the next slide, please. Ah, this is really great. This was trialed by 350 in Australia. So this is a, so sometimes it's really difficult to get to the CEO of a company. I don't know, a company like Nestle or whatever. You've got the email of the CEO or something, the next best thing to the CEO. But the CEO is not really replying to your emails, and you've got, you've encouraged your members to write to him. The CEO, of course, can also be the bank manager of a bank in your neighborhood or a local company. It doesn't need to be a multinational company. It can be a company at any kind of level. Anyhow, the super duo is not responding. And so what 350.org in Australia did, they sent him a calendar request. And so on the image you can see here in the dark blue, these are all calendar requests sent to the CEO of a company from citizens asking for a meeting with him. And as you know, in order to send a calendar request, you just need the email address of the CEO, and then it will automatically go to his calendar. So he or she will get your message this time round. Again, this is a really effective tactical tool that doesn't cost a penny. It's just about sending an email. Right, let's go to the next slide. Ah, this is another good one. I mean, in the COVID times, everybody is using Zoom right now, right? Zoom calls all the time. I mean, yeah, we're in a call as well. But Zoom seems to be the platform that everybody uses. And as you know, in Zoom, you can change your background. You can set your background. And so MoveOn.org in the United States, they just had the elections, and they produced a background picture for their election campaigns to get people out to vote in the United States. But you could basically use, you could basically design, it's a simple JPEG or GIF that any one of us can design. You can even do it in Canva. And you could design a background that is about your local campaign that you're having at the moment, and you could share it with your members. You could even make it a Christmas present to them and encourage them to use it and to set it as their background picture whenever they meet people and talk to people. It's a nice way and a subtle way and an elegant way to get something about yourself across to other people that know you perhaps only through work or whatever. Again, it doesn't cost a penny. Anyone can produce a JPEG or a GIF. Right, let's go to the next one. Oh, this is it's again a great one. It doesn't cost a penny. We call it the wall of solidarity or the wall of shame, depending on your target. This is something that you can do both in the virtual world or in the real world. It's post-it notes with messages from citizens to the target or to a community in solidarity. So the pictures that we have here are from New York and from Hong Kong, where activists posted messages of hope to each other at a time of crisis. And they posted it close to, in public spaces, close to metro stations or tram stations for everybody to see and to, again, to post messages. And some of them are really powerful. I mean, I don't know whether you can see it. There's one who says here, we are one, never give up. And when you read that, especially now in these times, when you revolt against something, but you revolt with compassion and with hope, I think that this can be incredibly powerful. It also shows how many there are and the power of the many and the humbleness and the insistence and the determination. I find that really, really powerful. You might think that this might not work in your country because they will not have a survival rate because they will be taken down. But you could also go to your town hall and you could rent a public space that usually companies or other people use as a space that you can rent, basically, from your village hall in your city or in your town. And you can start with one such space. And that is something that nobody would be allowed to put down your post-it notes. I think it's a great symbol of solidarity. Yeah, let's go to the next slide. Right, these are about giant balloons. Well, these ones cost quite a bit of money, but they can become an icon. The media loves these kinds of gigantic balloons, and you can use them and reuse them several times. So to your left, you can see a pig. This was used by the German open organization Compact. They have been campaigning for a long time against industrial farming, and they wanted to put pressure on their Ministry for Agriculture to stop the sale of cheap meat. You know, meat today is filled with hormones, is filled with antibiotics, and it's sold very cheap. And they wanted to stop that. And so they built this pig. And they put it to the, they took it to the Brandenburger Gate in Berlin, and they had a really great act. In the middle, you can see, of course, the fat cat, which always symbolizes the big corporation that is screwing the small people. And you can see it here. And then to the other side, you have big balloons on which is written "Save the Climate," and you have a balloon with the Earth as it is now, green and blue and beautiful. And to the right, the same, but the Earth in black and red burning. What you can also do is that several campaign organizations have these balloons. And if you like one or the other of them, you can ask them to rent it. I've done that several times, that I've asked campaign organizations if I can borrow one of their prop-ups, one of their balloons, because they are too expensive for me to produce and only want to use them once. And so, for example, you might have seen a very iconic balloon of the former US president, and you might want to borrow it, or you might want to change it or something like that. So it's always worth also considering to contact the campaign organization that owns the balloon and to ask if you can borrow it. And usually what happens in the past that I then send the FedEx costs or the posting costs for sending it to me, and then I return it to them. And that's also a great way of doing it. Let's go to the next slide. This is one I love. I think it's so cunning. It was used by or developed or the first time that I came across it by Hifted, which is the open organization in Sweden. So Sweden has an oil corporation called Lundin, and Lundin is a pretty common surname in Sweden as well. And so what Hifted did is they sent an email to their members with that same surname, Lunding, asking them to sign an op-ed, an article in a newspaper, denouncing that Lunding is using their good name. I thought that is such a great strategy. If you think that this is not possible in your country, well, let me give you some examples. For example, in Romania, where I lived, there was a mining company very active. They are called Gabriel Resources. Gabriel is a very common first name. And just imagine if you were to contact all your members that have the name Gabriel and ask them to join you in an open letter in a newspaper asking Gabriel Resources not to use their good name and not to put their good name through such bad PR. I think that could be very effective. Right. And with that, I think we've come to the end. I wanted to share with you now, I will do that in the general doc. Obviously, these are just a couple of ideas that we've shared with you now, but we made a list where you can see more ideas. I've just shared it with you in the general chat. This is, you can keep it, you can add to it. I hope you will like some of the ideas. It would be great if you could add some of your ideas. I'm sure that you have great tactical, I don't know how you would call them, tactical special, well, some vitamin H, actually, that you have some humorous tactics that you have trialed over time and that you always come back to. So we pulled these ideas from a golden treasure chest, but it's a spreadsheet. Maybe you can add yours. And make the golden list even more golden. So we can use it, all of us together. So please keep this list, add to it. And if you like some of the stuff, let us share. And let's keep feeding each other with vitamin H. So thank you, everybody, for listening.